So, last session is just an introduction to classes and we'll continue the topic again. So, I discussed just based on the application setup, what are the organization details and application name details given. So, it will be automatically creating some classes in the background. So, in that, so what are the classes generated here? These are user defined. See, after these classes, if you see, once these are generated, we will just know what type of classes these are and what is their importance we'll know. So later when we are working, start working on the rules, it will be easy for the developer to where we are creating the rules and when and where we have to create the rules, it will be easy for a developer to understand. So some, even though it is not mandatory to know, so it will help you to understand more about this Pega platform. Okay, so it will be easy to understand Pega platform well. Actually, so many will not discuss these points also. So, but if you know what type of layers and what type of classes we have, so this will help you to understand Pega better way. Okay. Apart from that, that is nothing mandatory, but just know what are the types of classes we have. So in this, I said that predefined and user defined. In predefined, some 13 to 14 classes we have, and in the user defined, layers are generated, three layers: work, data, and integration layer. And every layer is a combination of organization, division, and unit names. So after these names are generated, generally all these classes will be either abstract or concrete. So any reusable classes we have in the platform, so those come under abstract. Only thing is, in abstract class we can add the rules, but we cannot compile them. Again, if want to use or reuse or compile in the application, so we need to map it in the work layer or work classes we have to map. That is, in concrete we have to map. So today we'll understand what is concrete. So yesterday I discussed, except your work layer in the platform right now, remaining all the classes come under abstract classes. So here all predefined, data layer, integration layer, organization and division classes come under abstract. So now in the concrete, we are going to understand few types. See, in concrete we have three types are there: is a class group, belongs to, and does not belongs to. See, basically the meaning of concrete is, in this we can add the rules, reuse the rules from abstract classes, and also we can execute them, or we can also compile them. So, but again, compilation can be done only in the first two types, okay, not in the third type. Okay, in this I cannot compile the data. That process, again, when I discuss about the flows and executing them, at that time I'll gain more information I'll give about that, why we cannot compile in the does not belongs to class group. So basically in concrete, what we can do means, we can reuse the data from abstract classes, and also we can compile the rules. Okay, so that is advantage in abstract and concrete. If they ask any main difference, in abstract we can create the rules, and in concrete also we can create the rules, but in abstract classes we cannot compile the data, but in concrete we can reuse and compile the data. In the concrete, in the first two types we can compile, but as of now know the statement, in concrete we can compile the rules. Again, when I discuss more about the categories we have in this, then you'll understand where we can compile and where we cannot compile. Later in the coming classes, interview questions I'll be discussing, then I'll discuss more about this. So, and in concrete we can also call it as initialized classes. See, for this no need to have any knowledge on any core Java or anything else. Just if you know the terms here, what is the meaning of concrete and abstract meaning, that is enough. So in abstract we cannot compile, but in concrete we can compile the data. Okay, but in concrete we have three categories are there: is a class group, belongs to, and does not belongs to class group. See, is a class group, as of now this is available in the application after application generation. So is a class group is available, so which is nothing but your work layer come under concrete is a class group. But in the future, so we'll be defining some classes, some more classes we need to define. Okay, but not manually. Again, for every class creation some wizard will be available. Okay, the thing is, when you take every layer here, so any layer if you take, under every layer we can add some subclasses we can create. So if you take work layer, under that we'll be adding some work classes, so which are also called case types. Other name is case types. So suppose if you want to divide your application to more modules, so five modules if you want to divide means five work classes we can define, or five case types we can define. That is one thing. In the data layer we'll define tables, data types or data tables we'll call in Pega. So when you define that, it come under data classes. And when working on integrations for every service or connector, separate integration class will be created. So like that in the application now only layers are generated, but again in the design wise, whenever we get a requirement, so we'll define some subclasses under each layer. Under work layer we'll define work classes, under data layer we'll define data classes, under integration layer we'll define integration classes. Again, at that time no need to particularly mention what type of class it is, so we'll use some wizard and automatically, so it will generate in the background. So manually no need to set anything. So when you generate the setup and all, automatically what class type it is and what class it is, automatically it will be created. Okay, so just we need to know, so how to define them, you'll understand in the coming sessions, you'll understand more about that. Okay, but so as of now we know work layer commander concrete is a class group, data layer commander abstract, and integration layer commander abstract. So anywhere you work in the real time also the same setup will be there. Maybe your organization name and division names can be different, but everywhere the setup process will be same. So here, so I want to show some chart again. See here, maybe the font size is less according to the image screen. So but if you see initially alpha if and alpha type and work, which commander concrete is a class group. Okay, and we know data layer it is come under abstract. See, abstract classes we used to call it as not a class group, because per implementation application only one class group only will be there, that is your work layer. So data layer and integration layer come under abstract. So which come under, so those are not a class group. Okay, and in the future if I define any subclasses under work layer, I can define any number of subclasses based on the number of modules we create. So at that time any subclasses defined under work layer, those come under concrete and the type will be belongs to class group. That will be automatically generated. Only thing is we need to provide the names for the class. Automatically those come under concrete belongs to class group. Why belongs to means under the class group we are creating. So automatically they have set the type as belongs to class group. So these all manually we don't set. When a class name is given, automatically after submission this type will be generated in the background. Okay, and apart from that, when you're creating any subclasses under the data layer or integration layer, those come under concrete does not belongs to class group. So why it will take does not belongs to class group means because under the abstract classes if you define any subclasses, so those come under concrete but they have given a category as does not belongs to class group. Like that in the future in the integration classes if you define any, so those also come under concrete does not belongs to class group. So like that, so these are all the classes available in the platform. Just make a note of these terms and just remember these terms. Automatically anywhere you work, these classes and these terms only will be there and these types only will be there. So quickly, so like that in the application, why does not belongs to they have given means because this is not following the inheritance path of work layer. Under work layer if you define, it will come under belongs to class group. Under data layer or integration layer if you define, so those come under does not belongs to class group. So these are fixed in the platform and those will be generated automatically. Just if you know the types and all, that is enough. So like that in the concrete, the three categories are is a class group, your work class group or work layer come under is a class group, and any work classes are defined under the work layer. If you define any work classes or subclasses, so those come under, so belongs to class group. So like that you can add any number of belongs to class group in your application. So when I define case types, you will get this thing guys. Okay, and again if I define any tables and integration classes, so those come under does not belongs to class group. So like that in the application, again when I define those things, so as of now, okay, once you join mute microphone 7, you can mute microphones. So like that whenever again I define those subclasses, at that time again I'll give some more information. As of now just go through the document, what type of classes if you know, that is enough. Whenever I create a case types or data types, so again more information you'll get, how to define them and what are the explorers or what are the wizards will be having to define them, you'll understand later. Okay, and other things is, see here, every class if you take some parent class will be there. Mainly I'm talking about the layers. Okay, if you take any work layer or data layer or integration layer, it will be having some parent. Okay, if you take your work layer, so the work layer will be having a parent as in some versions it will be having work hyphen, and in some versions it will have as, nowadays most of the versions it will have as work hyphen cover hyphen will be there. See, these are like predefined classes. So I mentioned some predefined classes listlet. So for work layer, the parent will be work hyphen or work hyphen cover hyphen. See, under this work hyphen or work hyphen cover hyphen, all your functionalities, main templates are configured. See, without these parent classes, we cannot reuse the data and we cannot work on the, we cannot define anything in the platform. So already when application is generated, so for every layer, again, some parent class will be configured. Like that, if you take data layer, data hyphen will be the parent here. For integration layer, int hyphen will be the parent. See, where did you see these names in parent class? In the predefined classes, I mentioned these names, int hyphen, data hyphen, work hyphen or cover hyphen. So these are all some predefined classes. So for the layers which are generated, automatically it will have some predefined classes as the parent. Okay. So like that, these abstract and concrete class, any class generated in the platform, so either it will be abstract or concrete, and that is Pega defined. We don't change or we don't manually set that. Just what are the class types we have and each class come under which type, if you know, that is enough. Okay. And other things is, once these classes are generated, like this inheritance also will be generated for every class. But in Pega, again, inheritance is nothing but any data I found to reuse from parent to child. See, yesterday I showed one image, right? Again, I'll open that. See, inheritance is nothing but if any rules are there in parent, we can reuse in all the child classes, we can reuse. If I have any data in the organization, I can reuse in all the divisions and all the units, I can reuse. Or if any data having in the division, I can use in all the units, I can use. If any data is there in the division 2, I can use in all the units under the division 2. So like that, inheritance will be automatically generated. Any class is created in the backend. So at the time of class creation, inheritance also will be created. See, in Pega, inheritance is categorized as two types, pattern and direct inheritance. Okay. So pattern and all, just a connection between the classes. Suppose I'll open application and I'll show you once. I log into platform. So this is the ID we generated and I'm using that ID to log into the platform, and rules is the password. And once we log in, we open this admin studio first. Okay, so who joined you? So just go through the previous videos once if you missed the past three sessions. So it will switch to admin studio, and from here we need to switch to studio. See, when you open it, it will go to recent items, like what are the things recently opened in the platform. So recent explorer will be there, it will open that. Okay, but most of the time design will be adding from app explorer. So go to app explorer. So when you open this, you can see these classes and all. Okay, see, now I told you yesterday how to open any class and check the type of class if you want to know, either from sysadmin category or right click on the class and click on definition. Okay, if you right click on class and click on definition, you can see what type of class it is, and there itself you can also see what inheritance is there also. You can see basically here inheritance pattern I'm going to first discuss. See, pattern is nothing but, see, there is a connection between these organization and division and division and unit, right? This hyphen is there, right? Actually hyphen will just to divide the class. Okay, so, or it will connect the class, we can say. So here in the background, so this hyphen or what are the connection we have, this is nothing but pattern. So the connection between user defined classes, so or the connection between every layer, in the layer we have like a group of classes are there, right? Organization, division and unit classes. So the connection between these classes is nothing but a pattern inheritance. Okay, and that is automatically generated and we don't change that pattern. But when you open this class, any class if you open, So that class inheritance, under that this pattern is represented by checkbox option. By default it will be enabled, okay? We'll never remove this checkbox, so we will never remove the pattern inheritance for any class in the application. Automatically any layer or any class if you take in Pega, so pattern will be automatically enable, okay? So if you remove what happens, suppose by mistake, or suppose if you remove this checkbox or disable this checkbox, what happens means, see, this connection will be removed, the connection between division and work will be removed. So in that case, any data we have in the parent, I cannot reuse in the subclasses. I cannot reuse, I can create directly in the work layer, but any data if I want to reuse from parent to child, I cannot reuse. So basically we don't remove in any class or any for any class or for any scenario, we don't remove that. But if you just remove, what happens, I'm saying, okay, 200% will never remove the pattern, okay? But if you remove, what happens means there will not be reusability, will not be there from division to unit. At the same time, if this connection is not there, any data is there in organization also, we cannot reuse in the unit classes. So that is inherit, that is automatically generated in the backend. So we will never remove the pattern inheritance. Another point is, in pattern, a child can have one or more parent. If you take work, so it will have division as one parent and organization as another parent, super parent. So like that, in a pattern inheritance, a child can have one or more parent we can have, and it is represented based on this checkbox option, and it is optional. See, if you remove and save the class, means class will be saved. That is, they may ask you whether this pattern is mandatory or optional. Means it is optional, but don't worry, we will never remove, they will never remove manually. This checkbox will be automatically enabled. They will never remove this option in the real time, okay? Anywhere, not only in the real time, anywhere, we will never remove this checkbox option, but it is optional. If they ask you, pattern is optional, not mandatory, but it will be required for every class. It is required and automatically generated by the Pega application. So that is about the pattern inheritance, not more about that. So that is, pattern is created based on user defined classes, mainly particularly what are the class layers we have. So based on the class layers, connection between all the class layers, it is nothing but pattern, and it is represented by a checkbox option. And in pattern, a child can have one or more parent. Suppose in the future, if I define any subclasses under the work layer, okay, so then, so for this subclass, then the parent will be work, division, organization. Like that, in pattern, a child can have one or more parents you can have. See, same like that, you can check for the any other layer also, you can check. If you open data layer, for that also pattern will be there. So I'm also opening this data layer or any other layer. So here also you can see this pattern will be there for every class. By default, it will be enabled for every class. Okay. And the second type is direct inheritance. Okay. See, direct inheritance is nothing but, see, if direct inheritance is not there, we cannot save any class in application. That is, we cannot define anything in the application without adding this direct inheritance. Means you will not add, when Pega application setup is completed, I told you, for every layer some direct, some inheritance, parent class will be there. So that is nothing but direct inheritance. So it is given in the drop down. Already it is taken, every class generated, so it will be automatically taking that class. So if you take the work layer, I told, right, work hyphen cover hyphen. If you take in data layer, it will be data hyphen, or if you take integration layer, it will be int hyphen. So that will be automatically there in the generated in the backend. So, but without, suppose if you don't give this, what happens means, see, if direct inheritance is not given, we cannot reuse any functionalities in the application. And if class is not saved, direct inheritance is mandatory again. See, if I remove the direct inheritance and try to save, it will throw some error, because without direct inheritance, we cannot save the class. If class is not saved, we cannot define anything in the work layer or any other layer in the application. So because any design we are adding through layers, under the layers only we are going to define 90% of the design. So automatically any layer is created in the application. So this direct inheritance will be automatically generated. So if you know this, for every layer, if you take work layer, work hyphen or work hyphen will be direct parent. If you take data layer, data hyphen is direct parent. If you take integration layer, int hyphen will be direct parent. So that is automatically given. Any class, if you open and check, it will be there already. just we must know the what is the direct inheritance for each layer. So again, if I give some random class, suppose if I remove that, but I'm giving some random class, so this is also predefined. But if I give some predefined class, it will not take, because always the class should be inherited from its direct parent only, that is either workif nor any of its subclasses it is saying. So if you give some random predefined class, it will not take. Compulsory it must be, if it is a work layer, means it should be either workif or workif and coverif you have to give. If it is a data layer, means it should be data if. So just we don't change this, don't worry. Just you must know what is the direct parent for every class also, you must know. Okay, so mainly for the layers. So you know, points between direct and pattern is, in direct inheritance maximum we can give only one class, only we can give it as a parent, we cannot give more than one class. But in pattern means you can have more than one parent you can have, but in case of direct inheritance it will be having only one parent. See, one drop down is there, means maximum we can choose only one class only we can choose. So direct contains only one direct parent only will be having, and in direct inheritance it is mandatory. So without direct parent we cannot save the class. If you are unable to save the class, means any design also we cannot add in the application. So direct inheritance is mandatory, and if you take every layer, if it is a work layer, it will be work hyphen cover hyphen, as I said earlier. If it is a data layer, it will be data hyphen. If it is integration layer, direct parent will be int hyphen. So like that, for every class this inheritance will be automatically generated. Only thing is, just you must know, if they ask you what are the inheritance types you have and explain them, they may ask you. So pattern means the connection between classes is pattern, and direct means, so what is the direct parent and all, for every layer or every class if you take, it will be having some direct parent. So based on that only we are going to reuse the data, and based on that only we are going to add the design in the platform. So up to here, no need to add anything in the real time. So till here, in your real time scenarios, so the design, platform, everything, application setup, so this class configuration, everything will be set up. So from the next topic, whatever we create from there, the role of developer will be started. So till here, so no need to work on anything in the real time. So from the next topic, your role will be started. So when you try to access your application, till here the setup, everything will be ready. Okay. So but only thing is, just informational, as a developer you must know what are the types of classes, what is concrete and abstract, and in your application which classes come under abstract and which classes come under concrete, and what are the types of inheritance. Just review this document few times, so and know and understand the terms. Maybe once if you review you may not understand, so 2 to 3 days just open the document and just know the terms and technical terms and all, just understand. Maybe it may take some 1 week time, it may take some 4 or 5 times. If you refer, you may be familiar with all these terms. So maybe it may not come, we cannot remember all these things in one session. So every day before every session, or before at the end of the day, once review these notes, apart from that no need to do anything. Just know the technical terms and what are the classes come under, which classes come under concrete and which classes come under abstract, and what is pattern and inheritance. Know all these points. So up to here just know. Technically, if you know, that is enough. Okay, so from now, what is the next topic I'm going to start? So from there, the role of developer will be started. That is, we are going to work on the actual rules in Pega. And I told you how to check the, if you want to check any class, I told, right, if you right click on class and click on definition, so you can check what type of class it is and what inheritance is there. In the same page we can check. So if you right click on class and click on definition, so from there we can check. Apart from that, if you want to see the inheritance tree for any class, there will be something called inheritance tree. If you right click on the same class again, for any class you'll be having something called inheritance, that is read only, we cannot edit. Just we can see what is inheritance pattern and all for every class. We can check tree. Okay, here for your data layer, the parent is division. For division, parent is organization. For organization, parent will be data hyphen. And further, the superclass will be @base class. So I told you one point. In Pega, any class if you take, the superclass will be @base class. Okay, like that, this is the inheritance. It will be there in the backend. Like that, for every class, the inheritance will be automatically generated. If on to view, we can view in the backend. So that is about the classes. So only thing is just review these topics, just know the technical terms and understand the technical terms. Apart from that, nothing is required. Okay. Now, so from now, the next one we are going to start with is property rule. We can call it as data model, property rule, variable, fields, columns, anything we can say. So from here, we'll start the practicals. See, basically these any rule we work on Pega, so it will be initially some rules will be creating, and step by step we are going to map it in some other rules. So like that, initially any work is given to you, so most of the time we'll first of all start with properties. Again, in the application there are two ways to define properties, means two ways means directly from the modules we can start working, but directly in the case types I will show you in advanced classes. Initially directly I'm going to define in the work layers and all. But again, in the coming classes, 50% of the designs will be done in this process, and 50% will be done through case designer. What is case types and case designer? You'll understand after few classes. That is in advanced sessions, you'll understand that. Okay. So here initially, I'll be defining any UI design directly I'm going to create in the work layer. Again, in the future classes, I'll be creating modules like case types I'll be creating. Then I will again work on the case designer also I'll work. Okay. What are case management and case designer? Later I will work. So initially we are going to learn a rule called property rule. See, property rule is nothing but it's a variable. Okay. So means variable means, see, in every web application you will see some fields. Any web application if you open, you will be getting login screen where you will get some fields. If you again after opening that, you may get some registration screens and all, or some directly if you take insurance application, so where they'll be giving the information about the user, then vehicle information, there other information, step by step they're going to collect the details. So like that, any web designs if you want to create in the UI pages, if you want to develop, so first of all we need properties, not only in the UI design, so in order to map the data to tables, if you want to work on any conditions, business logic, so validations. So again, if you are working on any integration setup where again need request and response properties, see, in every place, in every part of design, so the main rule we are going to first start with property. Okay. So in some technologies we'll call it as a variable, in some technologies we can call it as a fields, some technologies we can call it as a columns. So anything is same. So here in Pega, the main term we'll be using as property. Okay. So here other thing is so property will hold the value. So wherever you use the properties, it will hold the value, or we can set some value to the property, or we can assign some values to the property. Okay. And again in Pega, the properties are categorized into three types. Okay. And before that, every rule we create in this application, see, it will come under some category. I told you earlier. So Pega contains different categories, and if you want to use them, if you right click on any class, you can see those categories. And property come under data model. Okay, there are many other rules are there in data model. Property is the main rule. Okay, and there are other ways are there how to define this, but property, we have three categories of properties are there: single value, page, and advanced properties. So today we are going to work on single value. About page and advanced properties you'll understand in the next classes. After two sessions we'll work on page properties, and few examples we work on advanced properties. Okay, but today I'm only going to more concentrate on the single value types, because so this is the initial level. Any property we create initially, so we'll define single value, then only we'll be working on page properties. So this one and advanced properties, I'm not giving any information, more information now, but these are the three categories, and today we are going to see how to define these single value properties. See, any property, the only thing is it will hold the value. Okay, so in single value properties, what happens means everywhere, suppose if you need in work layer or data layer or integration layer, every time we need to define manually. Okay, so in all the three classes, if you want to create separately, we can go for single value properties. Actually, in any UI design, whatever we see, single value properties only will be there. So what are page and other things, I'll discuss later. Page properties are reusable. We can create once and reuse in the application. Okay. And advanced properties also, it will hold more than one value for a property. When I define that, I'll explain about that. Okay. And in order to add these single value properties, Pega has given three ways. Okay, but in the present versions, only one process is recommended. Though we don't use other two process, I'm going to show few examples. Initially, we must know right all the ways. So though we use only one browser is recommended in the present version, but we must know the other two process also. We must know, okay, whether it is recommended or not. So we must know as a developer, we must know all the process. We must know how to define them. So there are three ways to define the single value properties. So one is, see, from data model property, two ways are there: create a property, quick create a property, and there is a third option called wizard. Actually, this wizard option is mostly used in the 8 version. From 8 version, this is recommended. These two are not recommended in the present version, from 8 version. Okay, so using wizard, so it is better to define the properties, but I'll show all the three process. Okay, see, whenever we define the single value properties, see, generally property is nothing but a field, so which contains some parameters where we need to give the name. See, like a first name, last name, age, city, email, phone number, etc., etc. These are all nothing but fields. Okay, or we can also call it as properties. See, any property rule we create here, some template will be there already. Okay, you'll just, only thing is, you'll just choose the options. If any options are there, we have to choose the options, or what is the name you are going to define, give the name for the property. So first parameter is name. Okay, then Pega has given all the types, like whether it is a integer or text or radio button or checkbox or drop down or whatever it is. So all the types will be given. We have to choose the specific type what we have to give. We have to choose the type. And there will be something called UI control. See, UI control is nothing but user interface control. See how your property is going to display in the application, and some basic validation also will perform. See, if you are using wizard option here, so automatically this UI control will be configured. When you set the type, automatically UI control will be configured. Only thing is, you have to only use the type, what type and all if you give. So UI control will be generated in the backend. So no need to set it manually if you are using wizard option. If you are using data model property, only for two or three property types only we have to mention it manually. Okay, that I'll show it. If time is there, I'll show this today. Otherwise, we'll see it in the next session. We'll see. So, but I'll show you first through wizard option how to define. I'll show you. So UI control means how property is going to display in the user interface and what is the validation it is going to apply. See, automatically based on type here, validations will apply. So that validations how to test and all, in tomorrow's session you'll understand. We can execute the flows and we can verify the, okay, not tomorrow, in after tomorrow session you will get how to verify the validations automatically. And there is some option called table type or configure field. See, using these sometimes for fields like a radio button and drop downs and all, we can assign some static records. So any static records if want assign from this option, we can define. It is not mandatory for every type field, only for like a drop down or radio button or autocomplete, such fields if you define then we have to assign some static records. So these are the parameters you'll be having when creating any property, mainly single value property. So property name will mention, we have to choose the type, and based on type UI control will be configured. And if any static records are required, static records are nothing but fixed records for the property. Again, in the future we'll load dynamic records also. So what are dynamic records? Means data storage, from the storage we are going to pull them. Static records means we'll define them manually, and those are fixed for the property. So some cases we'll define static records in some requirement. For example, gender is there, so gender will have a fixed records, right, like male and female. Like that, any static records are required, we can assign them using this last option, table type or configure field. So these are the parameters you'll be getting when creating a property rule. Okay, so let's see. See, like that, every rule will give some technical introduction before working on that, and more we'll understand practically how to use that and how to implement that. Okay, so now I want to add some properties using this wizard option first. Okay, then I will show you using data model property and this quick create a property option. I'll show you. So first let's start with wizard option. See, here properties I'm going to define under work layer. Okay, so most of the time UI designs will be creating in the work layer, and properties also I'm going to create in the work layer itself. And sometimes there are requirements where we'll create in data classes, we'll be creating in integration classes also we can define. But on practice, we'll know when and where to create the properties. Now, in today's scenario, we are going to define under the work layer. See how to open this wizard option means, see wherever you are going to define under that, you have to right click. That is right click on the class option. So you'll get an option called view in data designer. Okay, so this from here we can access this data model wizard or property wizard. So if you click on this view in data designer, so this will display a window in the right panel, or this is called as a work area panel. So after clicking on that view in data designer, now in the work area panel some wizard will open. Okay, so some window or wizard we can say. See here some default properties it will display automatically. Okay, so what are the three properties? See, Pega contains so many built-in properties again. So in that, in this wizard option, it will show some three list of properties it will show you. But what is their purpose and all, I'll discuss later. We'll be knowing some predefined properties step by step. At the time, I'll discuss more about this predefined. And see, what are the fields we are creating? These are user-defined fields. Like that, Pega contains some predefined fields. So their purpose is slightly different. So whenever we get a requirement, I'll discuss about that. Like what is PYID, what is status, what is label. That all will be working, compulsory will be working. So whenever I get a that particular scenario, then I'm going to explain about these properties. Okay, not today, but in the next 1-2 sessions you'll understand. So in any fields you want to define in the application, so click on add a field. And in the real time means what fields to define and all, you'll get a requirement, what name and what type you have to mention, and everything you'll get a specification, and accordingly how to give the names and so define the fields. So here I'm going to define some fields to collect the customer information. Okay, first I want to collect all the details of the customer. So for that purpose I'm creating some fields. So I'm giving some name as F name or first name, you can say. Say by default type will be text only. Okay, in the drop down other types and all you can see. So maximum all types will be given. Okay, so but if you don't find any exact type, choose the nearest one, because some more types you will observe in the UI design level you will be having. At the property creation level you will be having most of the types you'll be having. Suppose choose the nearest one. If anything doesn't compulsory, it will not suit your requirement, means choose the nearest one. So automatically it will be saved when you click outside the row. So your property is saved here automatically. Here no need to particularly click on save again, particularly in this wizard. Okay, other roles means when you open we have to save, but in the wizard option if you just give the name and click outside, automatically it will be saved. And here one thing is, see F name and ID, both it is taking the same thing, right? Here name is nothing but display name or display label we'll be calling, and ID is nothing but actual property name. ID means identifier. This is actual property name. See, suppose if want to change the display name, we can change. So if you again click on the same row, so we can customize the display name if you want. Okay, not mandatory, but so but in the display names, if you want to give like a full name with the spaces and all, you can give. But actual property name will be this one. Okay, but I'm not updating here. Mostly we'll update in the UI level we are going to update. Okay, but scope is there here also, scope is there. So ID is actual property, name is nothing but label. Okay, like that, add some fields in the wizard. Just give the name, type is text only for this also. Click outside, it is saved. Like that, I'm going to add some fields. So like that, Pega templates, everything like a template will be there. Just we need to use the template and fill the parameters. Like anything we create in Pega, like this only it will be. So age I have taken as integer. And I said right here, controls and all UI control will be automatically generated in the background. Okay, after these properties we can see under the class. So at the time I'll open and I'll show you. Okay, but in the wizard level, when you just mention the name and type, automatically control will be configured. And I'm going to give some other fields. See, for this Pega contains a dedicated type for phones and all, mobile number or phone number if you are giving. So Pega contains a dedicated type called phone. We have to use that one, not integer. We have to use the type as phone. And like that, I'm going to add some other fields. Email ID. Even for email IDs also, Pega contains a dedicated type. So which is email. Like that, today I'll be creating some types and other types and all. Will be every alternate session we'll be creating some new UI designs. So at that time, other types also will be working, guys. Okay, don't worry. In today's session, some types we'll be using. Other types we'll be working on the coming scenarios. And like that, I'm creating one field how to define static records. See, I want to add one drop down. Okay, and how to use the static records? I want to show you. So I'm creating a property called country. See, for this I want to assign static records. See, static records, if you want to assign compulsory, either you have to go for three types: drop down, radio button, or autocomplete. Okay, see, mostly means we will go for drop down. See, any drop down, autocomplete, or radio button, if you want to go, you have to choose a type as pick list. So pick list will support three display types. So if you select this pick list option, by default you'll get the display type as a drop down. So in the settings, now we have to configure the values. So I told configure field or table type, right? So if you click on these settings, so we can assign values for this drop down. Click on these settings, it will open some small dialog box will open. Wait, it will display. So here you can see the three options here available: drop down, radio button, and autocomplete. So by default you'll get the display type as drop down. If you want to change to some other type, we have to select in the drop down here, we have to choose. Okay, autocomplete, if you need, you have to choose autocomplete. And in the future, for any field, if you need radio buttons, you have to choose radio buttons as the display type. So by default it will take the display type as drop down. For us, drop down is only required for this. And here you need to give the list of values. What are the static records I said, right? So first value, give some caption. So first value can use a caption. So I'm giving some records. So these are static records and these are fixed for this property. Okay, so further they cannot add manually. They cannot, means during development they can add, but in the application is live means they cannot add. But for this kind of requirements, initially if you give any static records also, we may again later in the coming scenarios we may update these records to dynamic data, we will update. So how to do that? There are multiple ways are there in order to load dynamic data. That you will understand in the coming session. So if you want to give any static records during property creation, so like this we can assign the records manually. Okay, now click on OK. So these static records will assign to this field. Like one more field I'm creating, okay, same again, I want to again use this drop down again. So pick list I need to choose. So again, I'm keeping the display type as drop down. So first value I have given a caption. So like that, property creation, it's very simple. You can use anytime we can define property simply. What is your requirement? Okay, just I'm giving some records here. Click on OK. So now what are the fields I created in this wizard? So it will be saved under the your class. Okay, under the work layer, all these fields will be saved. So if you want to see that, so collapse this. See, but actually after opening and saving these properties in the wizard option, So here you need to refresh the explorer. See, by default only sysadmin you can see. Sysadmin means class is generated, that's why you can see sysadmin. But actually properties will be shown under the data model category. So what we need to do means, so you need to refresh once. So here you will be having this down arrow. So in this drop down, you have to choose this refresh app explorer. So if you select this refresh app explorer, so now under the class any data is added, it will refresh. Okay, so properties are added, right? So initially there is no data model, but after now, so after adding properties, you'll get this data model category. So expand that, expand data model, and expand that property. You can see all your properties list here. Okay, so what are the fields I created using wizard? You can see all the list of fields here. Okay, suppose now if you check each and every field from here, if you open and check, so now each field, if you open and check in the background, it will be created like this. So type is text. I said that it will be conferring some UI control, right? So what are the types selected, based on that automatically it will configure the UI control. Okay, like that if you open some other property, age, integer means px integer is the UI control. If you take email, see, type is text only. See, even though there you have taken as email as a type, so type is nothing but UI control here. Okay, so type, it will show the type as text only, but actual control name, if you see px email, will be there. Even phone number, if you open also, type will be text only, but control will be px phone. So based on the type chosen in the wizard, in the background UI control, what is the display for that property and what kind of input validation it will apply, everything it will take it in the background. So this is the main thing. UI control is the main for your property. And if you take the country property, so drop down we have taken country or state, I have taken drop down. So type is text only, but it will take the control as drop down. So like that. So here every property, when you define any property from the wizard option, so what are the type you choose, accordingly it will configure the UI control. And here other thing is, we have given some records, right? Some records are given for the property in the wizard option, but there only one set is given. But here after you open your property, it will create two set of records will be created. Actually by default it will create two things, standard value, prompt value. See, more about this I'll give some information, but again we'll practically update in the coming scenarios. See, difference is prompt value is called display value. Okay, so in the prompt value we can call it as a display value. Standard value is called as condition value. See, if you want to keep the prompt value like a display name, one second, so you can give the display name like this. For example, I'm deleting. See, here display name is, you can keep like a India, China, full name you can keep. But in the condition name, if you don't want to use the full names and everything, you can keep it like a short name you can keep. So for the standard value, you can keep it short. But we have to update manually. Open property and we have to update manually. So during property creation, it will take as one value only. But once we open property, so it will be like this. Prompt value and standard value will be, two values will be generated with the same name, but later if you want to update the standard value, we can update. Okay, not mandatory again. So whenever requirement we get, I'll show you when to update and when not to update. Okay, as of now I'm not saving this, but just I'm showing this option. Okay, keep it like that only, no need to change right now. When I get a requirement, when we work on conditions, if requirement is there, I'll tell you we have to change at that time. Suppose in the real time, in the future, if you want to move it like a code form, if you want to give directly in conditions when you're using these values, so standard value will be using as the condition value. So at that time we can make it short, instead of giving the full names repeatedly in conditions, so standard value we can use in the conditions after updation. Okay, that you'll understand again in the coming classes more about this. So like that, whenever we work on these properties, in older versions we'll do other process also, we'll create, but in the present version, in order to define the single value properties, so wizard is recommended. Okay, so most of the time we'll be using wizard, but I'll show you the other ways also to define the property. Give me one second. So first of all, any questions still here? Another thing is, if you're unable to see the immediately after creating the properties, so make sure you refresh, and refresh if you want to do, there are other ways also. If you right click on the class option, you can see refresh class will be there and refresh all will be there. Refresh class means only this class data will refresh. Refresh all means all classes data will refresh. And refresh app explorer I showed, right? Refresh app explorer, if you click also, it will refresh the entire data in this app explorer. Okay. Otherwise, there is other way is there. Refresh the browser. If you refresh the browser, it will switch to admin studio, it will switch. And from there again, everything, anything in the application, if you are unable to open anything or any option, if you are unable to click, just refresh the browser, then entire data will refresh. And once again, we need to switch to developer studio. Like that, we can refresh the data in the application in any one of these options, either refresh app explorer, refresh class, or refresh all, or refresh the browser. Okay, any one of these options we can use to refresh our data. So any questions first of all regarding these how to create single value property using widget option?
Yeah, hi Hari. For the country and state kind of data, right? Like, do we have any feasibility? Can have the full list of the countries and full list of the states by each country? Something
they will give. If you what records you have to send, you'll get the complete list of values.
And so the Pega is already,
and that one during development anytime we can update, no issue. Initially if you don't get any list also, later we can open the property and we can update, not an issue.
No, what I mean to say, like instead of we are updating manually, right? Like let's say like we have the 200 countries, or maybe let's say we have 100 countries, so instead of we are updating manually 100 countries, is Pega is
but
having a feasibility
static data auto... maximum, remember? Yeah. Maximum it will not be there, like more than 5-10 records only will be there. If you have such a list of values, you have to compulsory use dynamic data. Okay, so if you maximum up to 5 or 10 records means you can go for the static data. Suppose if you have like bulk records are there, compulsory will go for the dynamic records. So at that time any static data will not use.
Okay, dynamic data in the sense like the user can enter
unknown from the data storage we are going to pull that data. So in the data storage they are going to upload the data directly from file, they can upload. If you have many records means, and from that connect, from there we have to give the connection to the UI. We have to give the connection, and we'll work.
Okay.
We'll work on those dynamic records again.
Sure.
At the time, you will see there are many ways to fetch the dynamic data in the application. So after working on few scenarios, you'll get after some 1 week sessions, you'll understand those dynamic records how to pull. We'll work on that.
Okay. So, but the Pega will not contain like a full list of countries and full list of the states, right? Like, I mean, just I'm asking this example.
No. Static records means they don't give any full list. So, because dynamic data means they'll give the list like a file they'll give and you can upload in the data table. But static records, don't worry. Temporary records only will assign. Later, they'll compulsory, they need to change them. Initially, if the records is not there also, we can just give the control and leave it. See, records again, static records also not mandatory to give. Just to set the control and leave it. Okay, we don't give any records. We'll just for knowledge purpose, have given some records manually. Okay, if it is a gender kind of thing, then only see. Gender means everywhere it will be having fixed data, right? At that time we can give for countries and all, maybe again they may give the requirement exactly which countries that application is used. So accordingly we can use the country names. Okay, if they give the list means you can maximum use them. If they don't give the list means leave it empty. Later they can pull dynamic data, or when the list is available we can open and update the property values. No issue. That can be done anytime during development. Okay.
Okay, so just one more question for the reason behind this one, the special format types, right? Like email, phone. So basically while using this kind of types, okay, format types, so it will reduce like a kind of validation validation steps from our side. I mean, it will automatically do the validation,
right? It will automatically do the input validation. Again, additionally, if you need more, we can configure more. Okay, so input validation is already defined in the type level. So further, if you want to add any additional validation, there are again Pega templates are there again. 3 to 4 types of validations are there in Pega. We'll also work on that. Edit validate, OBJ validate, Okay, constraints like a different additional validations using functions and APIs are there. So using that also we can define. Okay, initially
okay, thanks,
it
sir.
will reduce the yes. Further, instead of defining any advanced validations, it will 50 to 60% of the validation template will be completed. Further, any more requirement is there, we can do it manually. So like that, based on property type, validations will apply automatically here, and automatically display format it will assign. Display format is UI control. So how it is going to display? Suppose radio button means directly if you use the property in the user interface design, it will assign that radio button control will assign. That you'll understand in tomorrow session. Tomorrow I'll be working on user interface design. So then in that you'll be understanding more about that. Okay. But anyway. Up to this option you can complete the today's task. So today just I discussed this property creation. Before that we discussed regarding class types and inheritance types. So tomorrow we'll see the other two types are there. Using data model property, there are two other ways are there. Just 5 minutes it will take. So tomorrow after creating properties, so all these properties how to use in the UI design we are going to understand. Okay, so any question?
Excuse me. Yeah. Can we link one drop-down list to other one? Like if I select
that is
India,
cascading.
I need to
come. Yes. Cascading. We'll be working on that.
Okay.
But not initially. After the storage, data storage, and dynamic records, I discuss some topic, right? So there are some topics like report definition, data pages. So after that, I'll be working on the cascading. So we'll call it as cascading the records. One drop down, based on one drop down, we can filter the values and display in the other drop down. Yeah, that we are going to work.
Also, the call conditioning, do we need to write any conditioning rules?
Yeah, we will work. Condition compulsory we have to write. Filter condition will be there. Okay, so that all come under report definitions and activities. When I cover those topics, we will be working on these concepts like this, we'll be working.
Okay.